Okay, let's wait one. Okay, I guess we could get started. So, you know, first of all, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on where you're joining us from. Welcome to day three of the workshop. My name is Chao Wu from IBM, and I'm one of the organizers of this workshop. First, I'd like to thank Dan Spern and the IMA for their support in making this workshop happen. We have four talks scheduled for today, and I'd like to remind the participants and attendees that to use the raise hand and the chat feature to ask questions and also to unmute yourself and ask questions as you like during the presentations. I'm also posting a link, and I think George is also posting a link to GatherTown in the chat box for the Q&A and discussion sessions. So please join us there after the talks. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker for the day, Elsa Cazelle from the Institut de Recherche Informatique de Toulouse, who will be speaking to us about streaming computation of optimal weak transport barycenters.
Thank you very much. Yeah?
Yes, go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. So yes, today I will talk about barycenter in the space of Wasserstein, of the distribution in the Wasserstein space. And I will not talk about the PD side of optimal transport. I will hope that it will still interest most of you, because I know we had a lot of PD talk, but this is not one of them. Okay, so first I will try to explain to you what it can be and why it can be interesting to use barycenter in this Wasserstein space, and why we came up with the idea to use weak optimal transport. And now we'll also introduce weak optimal transport. So this is a work that has been done with Felipe Tobar and Joaquin Fombona, my colleagues in the University of Chile, but I'm now in France. Okay, so first of all, why are we interested in the Wasserstein barycenter? Typically, when we have data, we will have something like that. So we can have discrete data, as in the right, or what we consider as absolutely continuous data. And from this data, we want to extract some shape, some general shape of the data. So in the left, you have the MNIST dataset, which is really known. And we can consider that each of the image is a probability distribution when we just normalize it and we consider that white pixels are, the value of the white pixel are one and the values of the black pixel are zero, and then we normalize it. This gave us a distribution. In here, we have the cytometry dataset, which consists in a flow of cytometry, projected in dimension two. So each histogram represents one patient, the cells of one patient, and the measure of each cells. So in here, you have approximately 200 measures of the same cell, of the same patient, sorry. So in here, what is interesting for the biologist is to gather the principle, the idea of the distribution of such data points, data clouds. And what is important in this special case is that they are not really interested in where they are in the space, but more or less how they behave one with respect to the another one. So we can see that it's kind of ellipse shape, you can say. And this is what is interesting when we see such cells markers. Okay, so when we have this kind of data, I am interested particularly in the Wasserstein barycenters. So for that, I will just put in here the definition of the Cantor-Rich problem that I'm sure is known by everyone in the audience. But just to fix the notations, in here I will consider, so this is the wrong P, but I will consider probability measures supported in the Euclidean space of dimension Z, which admits a moment of order 2. So that way I will be able to define the Wasserstein distance between mu and nu. So as you all know, I'm sure, a transport plant will have the information of the transference of the masses of mu and nu. So in pi, we really have this behavior of the mass that is transferring. Okay, so in here we have an example for absolutely continuous measures where p is a map, but I will talk about this later. And in here we have p that can split, and p is actually just a matrix in this case, in the discrete case. Okay, so now that we have the definition of the Wasserstein distance in the space of probability measures supported in dimension D, on Euclidean space of dimension D, I will just, okay, so this is not working. It's okay. So this was just an idea to show how the mass is moving along the L2 metric and the W2 metric. So I'm sure you all see this kind of measure, but just to recall you this, is that in the L2 interpolation, you will have the mass to move in the way, in the vertical way. Okay, so this mass will disappear and reappear in here, for example. Okay, and in the W2 interpolation way, you will have that the mass will mostly translate to the right and be pushed that way on the blue one. Okay, so it's a shame because it was really nice representation, but it's okay. Move to the next slide. So now the definition of the Wasserstein barycenter introduced by Hage and Carlier in 2011 is this one. So it's just the Frechemin with respect to the W2 metric squared. And we will try to find the distribution that will minimize the distance between this distribution and all of the other ones. Okay. So going back to this example, what was interesting in here was the way that in the W2 interpolation case, the support is really really important, because actually the mass will move along the support and will move, will translate, as I said, along the support. So for the W2 metric, the support is something that we really want to keep in mind, and why is it important? Okay, so a quick example. In this case, I have the first name dataset. So the first name dataset consists in the distribution of names in France in the 20th century. So it's from, it's 100 years, more or less. And the distribution of a baby born with that name for each year. Okay, so what we can see that globally, the behavior that came up the most is this one, okay? When we have a spike at some point in the century. So this is really like a trending effect, where when a name is given at some point in the time, at a time t, it will be given a lot before and after. So it's just a trending effect, something that can be really understood easily. So in that case, when we do barycenter with respect to the L2 metric, which consists just to superpose the histogram and then divide by the number of histograms, as we already know, we will obtain something more quantitative, meaning that we will obtain an information about how many births there was during the year 2000, for example. And we will have this kind of results. So in here, we can see that during the First World War and the Second World War, actually, there was less birth. Okay, but with a Wasserstein barycenter, so a barycenter with respect to the Wasserstein metric, we will really recover this shape, this Gaussian shape that we have noticed in the great majority of our dataset. And also we can obtain a quantitative information, because we see that this Gaussian-like histogram is a little bit translated at the end of the century. And this is because there is more mass at the end of the century. Okay? So this is why studying Vassar Steinberry Center can be of interest, because we really gathered the geometry information about our data set. So what happened when we have absolutely continuous measures? So this is a counter-rich problem, but in that case, for absolutely continuous measure, with respect to the Lebesgue measure in RD, we will have the Munch problem that was first introduced, actually. And we will be able to reduce the problem for the map, which are the measurable functions that push mu forward mu. Okay, so when we have this kind of map and we do the push forward operator, we arrive at mu. In this case, we have the Munch problem, and I'm sure again, all of you already know about that. So what it can be interesting to why it can be interesting to work with absolutely continuous measure is thanks to the really nice results. So in this case, So in this case, the problem can be written this way. So this is just the Wasserstein distance for absolutely continuous measures. And we have this really nice result from Alvarez, Esteban, and this co-author, and at the same time, Zemel and Panaritos, even if it cannot be seen in here, but this fixed point characterization. So if at least one of the measures we are doing, the Wasserstein-Berry Center with respect to the absolutely continuous measure nu1, nuk, so if at least one of these measures has a bounded density, then the Wasserstein-Berry Center is characterized by these formulations, where each ti are the optimal map in the Munch problem between the Berry Center and a measures. So why is this nice to have this kind of result? Is this because next, what we can do actually is an iterative procedure in order to obtain the fixed point. So in this case, it's mu bar, the Wasserstein-Berry Center, in order to obtain the fixed point. So in here, the ti depends on n, obviously. And each time it will be ti between nu n and nu I. And this way we obtain an algorithm that will converge towards the unique Wasserstein-Berry Center. So this is a really nice result. But what happened when we don't have the absolutely continuous assumption on the measures? So in this case, when one wants to get rid of this assumption, we can consider actually the barycentric projection. So the barycentric projection, it's actually a really simple object. So it is called barycentric projection because, as you can see, there is a notion of mean, but it has nothing to do with the barycenter in the Wasserstein space. It's just two notions of means. But when you have this definition, actually, it exists for any transport plan, P, which disintegration is actually defined as this. So we disintegrate it with respect to the first marginal, mu, and we obtain this map that always exists for any transport plan. Okay, so in this case, as you, I guess you see it coming, we will be able to use this map in this problem to have something like that is in the same taste, let's say. And this map will exist for any mu nu that are of any kind, that they just need to have the right moments. But otherwise, we can have them even if they are discrete measures. In particular, this map is actually optimal between mu and the push forward of mu s mu nu. Okay. And a second remark is that if the in here the P, the optimal transport plant is the optimal transport plant in the counterage problem, and that mu and nu are absolutely continuous, then the P is concentrated in the graph of a function, and then we will obtain that this S is actually exactly the transport plan, the optimal transport map in the Monge problems. So it's really, there is a lot of going of things that are happening here that are close to the optimal transport problem, but still there is something else in here. Okay, so now how can I choose the right transport plant in order to do my iteration processes? So first of all, as I said before, the barycentric projection can be constructed for any plan, transport plan. So this is in the discrete setting is actually just a multiplication. So the problem with that definition is that still we have to choose the right pi that will allow us to have something that makes sense, some kind. So depending on the plan P, of course, we will have we will end up on different measures. So if in here I have a really, really simple example where you have two measures, mu and nu, blue and red. And if we have this transport plan between mu and nu, we will have that the push forward of, oh, so this is not nu, this is mu, and here also. Okay, so the push forward of the S1 constructed from this transport plan will end up on nu. But if we have this transport plan, the push forward will end up on the Dirac that is centered. So now, what is the right way to choose the transport plan? So this actually is given to us from the paper of Goslin and co-author. And it is the notion of optimal weak transport problem. So the optimal weak transport problem is defined like this. So in here you will recover the barycentric projection, and actually we will minimize this quantity over the set of transport plan between mu and nu. But this is not, you have to keep in mind that mu push forward the barycentric projection is not nu. Well, it not has to be nu, okay? So it's different from the Wasserstein metric. Okay, so main advantages is that this problem, this infimum, is actually uniquely attained for any distributions. Meaning that even for discrete ones, this p, this pi is actually unique. Okay, and also this nice characterization. So via convex ordering, that has been done by Goslin and Juye, and also Bakoff and Vairagas and co-authors. So actually, this infimum problem is equal to this infimum problem, meaning that we are looking for the eta that is lower than nu in convex order. The convex order means that for any convex function phi, we have this ordering. Okay, so we are looking for the eta that is lower in the convex order than nu. That will minimize actually the Wasserstein distance between mu and this eta. Okay, and this eta actually is unique, same way is uniquely determined, and it can be written as the push forward of mu against the barycentric projection that is constructed with the optimal weak transport plan. or optimal transport plan, but for the weight problem in here then. Okay. So now, as well, I'm sure you were expecting that, but now I'm going to consider actually a weak barycenter, and I'm calling weak just because I'm looking for the barycenter with respect to the weak, to the optimal weak transport problem. Okay, so this weak barycenter, we prove that it admits solution. And then I'm going to try to give you an intuition on why is it different and how does it act. Okay, so first of all, we have this definition, this characterization. So therefore, since nu is always less than nu in convex order, we have that the weak optimal transport problem is always less or equal to the Wasserstein distance. So, okay, there is the nth missing in here, but what I mean is that the Wasserstein problem, the barycenter problem with respect to the optimal weak transport will be always less or equal to the Wasserstein problem with respect to the Wasserstein distance. The barycenter problem with respect to the Wasserstein distance. Okay. And another thing that is a nice characterization, what we can have in mind also, is that saying that mu is less in the convex ordering than nu, it's actually equivalent to say that there exists a martingale coupling between mu and nu. So this, we will not use it during this talk for this work, but which is, it's kind of interesting because there is a lot of things happening at the moment in the martingale optimal transport community. And so then I discovered all of this huge bibliography. And so I'm sure there is a lot of things that can be done in this community also. Okay. So some remarks. Intuitively, when we have two random variables of two measures that have the same expectation, actually saying that one is lesser than the other one in the convex ordering means that actually the distribution is less spread out. Okay, so there is this notion of concentration when you have a convex ordering. Another fact is that the Dirac centered in the mean, the weighted mean of the expectation of the new I is always a weak barycenters. So therefore, we can know the objective value of the infimum of the weak barycenter problem, and is equal to this quantity. Something else is that the expectation of a weak barycenter is always equal to the weighted sum of the expectation of the measures that we consider. This is also true for the usual Wasserstein barycenter problem. This is also true for any weak barycenter problem, but also for any Wasserstein barycenter problem. So in here, we can see the concentration of the measures. In some kind, the variance of the measures that has to be less than the weighted sum. There is missing a lambda e there, lambda I, of our measures. And a more explicit example, if we have all of the measures that have that share the same mean, m, then mu will be a weak barycenter if and only if mu is lesser than nu I in convex order for any I. Okay, so for an example with Gaussian distribution, when we have Gaussian distributions that are then all centered in the same mean with different variance, then the weak barycenter will belong to the space of Gaussian distributions with variance that are lesser or equal to to lambda I for each I. Okay, so we'll obtain a Gaussian distribution that is more concentrated around its mean. Okay. So now, as the same way we did for our colleagues did for the Wasserstein Barry Center, we can develop an iterative procedure in order to obtain the fixed point of the function g. Okay, in this case, the map in here, that was the optimal map in the Munch problem for the Wasserstein Barry Center. In this case, we will change it with the barycentric projection, which achieves the minimum in the weak optimal transport problem. But otherwise, it's exactly the same principle as for the Wasserstein Barry Center problem. So something that I already said, but still, it's kind of important, I think, is that when we do the push forward of mu towards the push forward operation of mu push forward the optimal map in the Munch problem, we will end up on mu I. Okay, so each time we will travel from the barycenter to through the optimal map, we will end up on the usual mu I. But for a weak optimal transport problem, so for the barycentric projection, this, first of all, we will not end up on nu I. Well, we can, but it's not sure. And also, it will still depend on nu. On nu, sorry. Okay, so I think that this should be kept in mind. That actually, we will not see the barycenter between all of the measure nu1, nuk, but with measures that are a little bit more concentrated or that are lesser in the convergence at each nu I, okay? So maybe to have this clearer in mind, okay. Oh, you cannot see that, it's okay. So I recall the definition in here. And I recall also that, I'm not sure that I've said that, but actually, saying that this measure is smaller than the new in the convex order, it means the martingale. It means that this measure and new, there exists a coupling, a martingale coupling between these two measures. Okay, and this actually can be written like this: there exists a coupling such that the expectation of z is eta in here, so this measures condition to y is equal to y. So what we can understand in here is that there is between nu and eta, there is something of a concentration, meaning that z is represented by eta, meaning that in mean, we are not too far away from the measures that we are looking at the beginning. I'm not sure I'm really explaining that in a greater way. So maybe with this figure, it will help. So in here, we have the source measures in blue, the blue crosses, the target measures in red. So mu is the source, nu is the target, and we in black we have eta, which is actually the source mu push forward the barycentric projection that is constituted from the optimal weak transport problem. Okay, so we can see that actually the black one is kind of the mean of the target sample, which is new. Okay, it tries to have a notion of means between all of the red crosses, and in black what I have Yes, in black it's a week, and in orange what I have, it's actually I computed the optimal transport plan from the optimal transport, the classical optimal transport problem, and I computed the barycentric projection from this transport plan. And then the push forward of mu against the barycentric projection of the OT transport plan, we will end up with the yellow points. Okay, so there is less, it's still really, really close to each other, but it, for once, it's different. And two, it has less, in here we can see it, it has less the notion of centering along the crosses, the red crosses. Okay, and then I, as I said before, actually this problem is greater than the problem. This is the problem, this V of mu, and this is V, it's not of SOT mu, I'm sorry, there is a mistake. It's the distance between mu and nu in here. So we have that the V between mu and nu is lesser than the W2 between mu and nu. Okay, so this is was just a detail. Okay. So now the proposition, what we have proven is that if mu is a weak barycenter, we will have that mu verifies a fixed point equation. And then that each sequences will subsequences, sorry, will converge towards a fixed point of G. What is a little bit annoying is that we don't have actually it's an ongoing work, and for now we haven't proven that when we have a fixed point of G, we will end up on a weak barycenter. But in the experiments, we have not seen something weird about this for now, but well. Okay, so now, as I promised at the beginning of my talk, I want to compute a barycenter for a stream of data. So in this case, we are receiving new observations. And an observation is actually a distribution. So for example, for the cytometry flu dataset that I presented in the beginning, it means that we are receiving more and more patients, okay, along the way. So for that, we will need a larger framework. And this has been studied by Bakov, Varagagas, and co-authors, and also by Shewi and co-authors also in the case of Wasserstein barycenters. And in this paper, it is in the case of the of Gaussian distributions. This is why they are considering Bruce-Wasserstein barycenters. They are calling that Bruce-Wasserstein barycenter. Okay, so for that purpose, I will consider a probability distribution. A probability distribution that is itself supported on the space of probability distributions. And I will define this weak population barycenter with which we proved Amit's solutions. And this weak population barycenter is actually just the continuous versions of the ones that I presented before. Because if Q is a sum of Dirac, of weighted Diracs, then we will end up to the same definition than before. Okay, because in this case, a probability distribution supported on Dirac's, each Dirac is actually represent a probability distribution. Okay, so in this case, we also have the fixed point idea that if mu is a weak barycenter, we will have this equality. And why is it interesting is that because of this equality also, we will be able to define the iterative algorithm, an iterative procedure. An iterative procedure procedure to which we converge towards a fixed point. Okay, so the iterative procedure, how does it work? We will begin with a measure that will denote a mu zero in here, and at each step we are given we have a new distribution, a random distribution that is sampled from Q, and we will have actually to compute the barycentric projection between our measure, our source measures, and the new target measure nuclei. And by doing so, we will end up on the on a fixed point of the function g that I presented earlier. Okay. Some remarks about the computational work around all of these ideas. Okay, so as I said, at each step, we have actually to compute a barycentric projection. And a barycentric projection is characterized, defined from an optimal weak transport plan. So basically, we have to solve an optimal weak transport plan problem. First, in the martingale optimal transport problem, the goal is actually to solve, usually the goal is to solve an optimal transport problem in here with the settlement that actually our the measures that we are seeing are already verifying a convex ordering constraint. Okay, and then since this convex ordering constraint correspond to a martingale constraint actually, which is written like this, we can always add to this problem this constraint, and we will end up to by finding a measure mu. A transport plan pi that is a martingale coupling between mu and nu. The problem in our situation is that if we are doing something like that, like adding a martingale constraint, since we are looking for this, we will try to find a martingale constraint if we are directly working on mu nu. Finding a coupling that verifies martingale constraint on mu nu will attain actually the infimum in here, because we will find a mu that is lesser or smaller or equal to nu in the convex order. That means that in here we will have zero. We'll always obtain zero. So not interesting. For the classical OT problem, something that is mostly used, as you all know, I'm sure, it's adding an entropy constraint or L2 constraint, and then to use a synchron algorithm in order to enforce the constraint on the transport plan P. Okay, but this also is not possible because in our case we don't have this linear definition, because the plan P is actually inside the Euclidean norm. Okay. So what we have done that seems to work quite well is to use a proximal algorithm to find to resolve this problem. So this is the optimal weak transport problem written for measure mu and nu that are discrete. So we aim at finding a pi that is a matrix which minimize this term, but which is still in with marginal mu and nu. By doing so, well, this is the indicator function of the set of the transport plan set. By doing so, we can write a proximal algorithm in this form that allows us to have the pi final. Okay, so this was just the idea. What we will obtain So these are ring distributions. So in colors, we have five ring ellipse distributions. And in black, you have the Wasserstein-Barre center, which is not, I'm going to say how I computed it. And in red, we have the Weak-Barre center. And in here, they are almost the same. Okay, so the Weak-Barre center I computed, as I said, with a proximal algorithm. And at each step of the, at each step, I'm receiving a new ring. Now, each step, I'm traveling between between the rings. And the Barre center here, I computed it using also the barycentric projection, but for transport plans that are verifying the optimal transport classical problem. So doing the barycentric projection from an optimal transport plan that is obtained through an OT problem, classical OT problem, it can be done. But, and it is done a lot in practice. But the problem, I think, is that it doesn't have a real signification. We don't really know what it means to do a barycentric projection of the optimal transport because of the optimal transport plan, because it does not solve an optimal transport problem, this barycentric projection. Okay, and also just another example for the cytometry dataset that I presented to you at the beginning. In here, you have the usual barycenters that I constructed the same way as I said before, and the weak barycenter in red. So in here, we can really see that actually the weak barycenter is more concentrated. And this is because we have considered the main idea of the weak barycenter is for each measure, we will seek for a measure that is lesser in the convex order ring. So which is a little bit more concentrated. And at the end, we will obtain this kind of results. Okay. I want to do, so this is an ongoing work, but what I want to do, it's an acceleration of the proximal algorithm, because I'm sure there is a lot of mean to, this is really the first level of the algorithm, and I'm sure that it can be accelerated easily. And then to find better suited application in that way, is that what is nice is the, as I said, connection with the Martingale optimal transport problem. So I guess there is something here that I am still missing to understanding of where actually in which setting it will be really more interesting to look for a weak barycenter and it will have more significance. Okay, so thank you for listening.
Oh, thank you, Elsa. Let's give our round of applause. Any questions from the audience?
I have a question. So basically, first of all, thank you, Elsa, for this very nice talk. I really enjoyed it. So I have a question with regard to convergence rates. I mean, you know that your method converged to a fixed point, right? But do you have any results in the context of convergence rates?
Absolutely not. So with respect to the convergence rate, actually, the work done by
my question is because at the end you wrote that you are working on accelerating the algorithm. So when accelerate, you mean accelerate what, right? Because
first of all, accelerate the proximal part when computing the barycentric projection.
Okay.
Yeah, and then actually in this paper, it's really nice paper, they have done the same thing, but for considering only Gaussian distributions, which is already something, and their results are really, it's the theory is really hard. So for this kind of simplified, simplified setting, it's still really, really hard. So I'm guessing that.
Okay.
But
yeah,
I would love to have some convergence rate, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this can be, I think this can be applied to the context of data simulation. You can see like the prior distribution and the posterior distribution as a result of a transportation map, or transport map. So this looks very improvising in that context as well. Okay.
Yeah, actually I've done some experiments, but yes, you're right. Thank you. With this kind of setting. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, cool. I will contact you later. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Hi, Elsa. It's Aud for the talk. So I think it's a really interesting new concept for barycenters. And I was curious, or maybe I missed the first couple of minutes, but what do you think will be the advantage compared to the traditional formulation? Like what kind of settings do you think it will be better for, or what applications do you think it will work better?
Hi, Aud. Actually, this is something that I want to work on it, because at the beginning, when I developed this idea, it was really because it was something natural to look for not a map in the Munch problem, but to look for something that has the same taste of a map, that looks like an optimal map, but that exists in every situation for every distribution. So when I developed it, I had just this in mind. And now that I'm seeing the connection with the Martingale optimal transport, and I guess looking for something in this area might provide some insight on what is the true difference between these two barycenters and why it can be interesting. So for now, I'm still thinking about this. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? If not, I have one question. So in the Wasserstein barycenters, you have sort of a compact combination of the Wasserstein distance. And then in your case with the V, it's the squared of the Wasserstein distance. Is that cause any difference between the two?
Well, V is still convex with this formulation. And actually, you can see it quite easily in here. And I'm guessing that, well, for now, I don't know. There is still ongoing work on the dual, for example. There is a nice paper that just came out about the dual, that I have a dual of this problem. That looks like a lot of the Wasserstein barycenter dual, the counter-rich for formulation. But for now I'm just trying to find something to understand what it does really, and I'm just at the beginning, really. So I'm sure we will obtain really similar concept and really similar results. About the Lipschitz of the gradient and all the Lipschitzity of the gradient, something like that. I think we can obtain it also in this case. Yeah.
Thank you. If there's no questions, I guess we can move the discussion to the Gather Town. The link is in the chat, and I think we'll see you all there. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.